Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from Pastor Luke Cobray.
Amen. Well, tonight I wanted to talk to you about a subject that the title of tonight's message, if you're going to take notes or you want to remember it or you want to recall it later on, is consciousness. Consciousness. You see, I wanted to talk to you about consciousness. Why? Because consciousness is something that you and I all walk through in life. And what consciousness is, simply defined. When we look at this word consciousness, consciousness simply defined as this, is to be awake or to be aware of the surroundings or the things around us. To be conscious of what's going on, to be open and alert to what is happening around us. And I remember, you know, many years ago, right before my wife and I got married, I had surgery on my nose. I like to tell people I got a nose job. But it really wasn't like one of those nose jobs, right? A long time ago, long story short, my brother-in-law, Pastor Henny, who pastors our church in our sister church in Temecula, Rock Church of Temecula Valley, he broke my nose playing football in the backyard. Now, when we started this church, when Mom and Dad started this church, you know, we lived on faith and fumes. Amen. We still live on faith and fumes. But with that, we didn't have health care. So, you know, they kind of looked at me and they prayed over my nose and they said, amen, it'll be great, it'll be good. Unbeknownst to us, it was broke. And it healed laying sideways on my face. Like literally my nose went like that way. And it was always just kind of something that bothered me. And one day I went to the doctor. And when I went to the doctor, he looked up my nose. He shined a little flashlight up there. And he said, wow, you need to get your nose fixed. And I'm like, man, I've lived with it all my life. And so I had to have surgery for my nose. And I remember when I had surgery, I remember sitting in there, my wife, who was my fiance at the time, and my mom, they took me to the doctor's office, to the clinic where we were to have surgery, and there I was laying in the bed, and the lady told me, you know, she was giving me the IVs and all the different things before surgery. I got to wear that really terrible hospital gown, you know what I'm talking about, where like the back, I don't know why they make you wear that, it's the worst thing in the world. And there I was laying in the bed, and I remember the lady telling me, she said, this is what's going to happen, this is what's going on. And they wheeled me into the room, and I just remember all the lights, and I remember laying there. And it was under all the lights, and the doctor was leaning over me, and the anesthesiologist that was leaning over me, and they had their masks, and they were talking to me. And all of a sudden, they asked me to count backwards from 100. And I got probably to 99. Literally, we watched a movie last night where we saw it, and it was like, that's just the way it was. I think I was 100. Right? I was gone, unaware, unconscious while they operated on my nose. And thank God I was unconscious because after they told me what they did, I am so glad I had no clue. But I remember the weird feeling. It was an odd feeling because I woke up and there I was in the recovery room and my mom and my fiance, Stacy, or not my wife, and some of my family members, they were all there and they were leaning over me, watching me. And I remember I kind of blinked a little bit and I kind of shrugged off a little bit and all of a sudden everybody's leaning over me and there was this awkward feeling of not being aware of what went on. I don't know what they were talking about. I don't know if they were talking about me. I don't know what the doctor said. I don't know what had happened. I don't know how much time had transpired. I literally was unconscious or unaware of my surroundings about me. And it was the most uneasy feeling I've ever felt. I mean, it was just so weird. And then the doctor came, hey, Luke, are you there? You know, and I'm kind of groggy and waking up a little bit. And they explained my nose and what they did. And, you know, praise God, everything's better now. And I'm thankful for that. But I just remember that feeling of unconsciousness. You see, we all live in a state of consciousness to be aware or to be awake of our surroundings. The question is, what state of consciousness do we live in? What is your state of consciousness? In what way, in what areas of your life are you awake? Are you aware? Are you looking around and are you acutely aware of what's going on? Because ultimately all of us, every one of us, live in some state of consciousness in our lives. Some of us live, and when I was writing this message, I'll just tell you today, so that way if you think, man, I'm preaching to you, I didn't even know what to say about you, I was just preaching to me. These are things that I've gone through in my life and that I deal with on a daily basis, but some of us, I know you can relate because we're all here just trying to work out our salvation. And some of us live in this state of self-consciousness. When we're aware of ourselves, when we're aware of everything that we want, everything that we need, everything that we desire, we are seeking to fulfill the pursuit of happiness that our country tells us is our God-given right. We are self-aware of our lives, and that's the consciousness that we live in. Some of us in this place, some of you in this place today are living sick conscious, where your body has ailments. You've got sickness or you've got pains in your life. You've got burdens or bondages that you've been holding on to or that have been holding you back. And you are acutely aware of what your sickness, of what your pain, of what your body, of what your life is going through. And we are sick aware of our lives. Some of us in this place today are, I would call it world conscious. When I say world conscious is simply conscious about what everything is going on around us, what people are saying about us, what everybody else is doing. Did you know that there's actually now a psychological issue that people have, and I don't even know what the scientific name is, but it's the fear of missing out. That everybody gets so wrapped up in social media and everybody gets so wrapped up on Instagram and Twitter and Facebook and Periscope and Snapchat and whatever else is going on, whoever knows what's gonna come out tomorrow, that they're afraid of missing out. And so literally, they're watching people eat dinner because they wanna know what this person is doing. We are so world conscious about what's going on around us. Maybe it's what's going on with your kids or your family or what people are saying about you or thinking about you. Maybe it's just the latest fashion trend, or maybe it's what's going on over in New York or what's going on over here, what's coming around the bend. We are world conscious of what's going on around us. How about this one? Many of us live sin conscious. Conscious of our shortcomings, of our failures, of the mistakes that we make, of the issues that we can't seem to shake, of the problems that come at us on a day-to-day basis. Sometimes we win, most times we lose. And we live our lives awake, aware, every moment of our lives reminded of what we do and what we've done, living sin conscious. Some of us in this place today are just straight unconscious. Oblivious to the world, wandering aimlessly about, wondering, when is my time gonna come? I desire for my life to change, and I'm just waiting for Jesus to show up and do it. I'm waiting for God to change my life, and we are living unconscious, oblivious to the world around us, oblivious to our lives, oblivious to what's going on in our wives or our children's lives. We are unconscious in our lives. See, some of us in this place are living some of these consciousness. And the Bible tells us there is a way that you and I have got to live. We all live in a state of consciousness. What is that state that we should live in? Well, let's look at what the Word of God says. If you've got your Bibles, go with me to the book of Hebrews. Hebrews in the 12th chapter. I mean, it's a known verse. It's like so known that most of us already know about it anyways, because it's a known verse, right? Hebrews chapter 12, verse number 2. Hebrews chapter 12, verse number 2. Now I know you say, Pastor Luke, we're going through the book of Hebrews. I know. Pastor Dan made the announcement. It has taken us 5 years to get thus far. So I feel relatively safe, even though we're in Hebrews chapter 11, I feel relatively safe that we won't get to Hebrews chapter 12 anytime soon. So I felt like it was okay. It's not quite in that territory yet where we can't touch it, all right? In a couple of months, maybe. But right now, I think we're okay. So Hebrews chapter 12, first of all, verse number 1 tells us to lay aside the weight and the sin that so easily ensnares us and to run this race of life. But verse number 2 tells us the state of consciousness that we should live in. Verse number 2 of Hebrews, the 12th chapter, says, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despising shame, has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. You see, the Bible tells us there is a consciousness that we need to live in. And that consciousness is not sin consciousness, church. That consciousness is not self-consciousness. It's not world consciousness. It's not sick consciousness. And it certainly is not unconsciousness. The consciousness that we have got to live in our lives is Christ consciousness. To be aware and to be awake to the fact of the matter that Jesus Christ is the answer to everything we need in this life. Not just our problems, but our pleasures. Jesus is the answer to everything we need in our lives. Judging by the response, some of y'all aren't Christ conscious, because that ought to get us excited. Why? Because Jesus is everything we need. Everything we need. Everything we desire. Everything we need to get beyond our shortcomings and our trials. Everything we need to raise our children. Everything we need to be good employers or employees. Everything we need to survive the day-to-day struggle of life comes from Jesus. And we've got to be Christ conscious, to look to Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. The Bible says the Lamb of God slain before the foundations of the earth. Jesus is our all in all, and we are to look to him as our consciousness, to be awake, church, to be aware, church, that Jesus is everything we need in our lives. The Bible tells us clearly, Hebrews in the third chapter, it's not on the verse, it tells us to consider our apostle and our high priest, Jesus. To consider means to think about, to ponder upon, to meditate on Jesus. You see, he is everything we need to focus on in our lives. But like me, I take the time and I focus on self. Like me, if you're like me in this place, you focus on sickness, you focus on the world, or you focus on what else is going around you. But today, we've got to see and realize that we are to be Christ conscious. The title tonight is consciousness. Really, it should be Christ consciousness. Why? Because that is God's desire for us, to always focus on Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. And tonight, I'm not going to give you how-tos. I'm not going to tell you how to be Christ conscious. Why? I believe how-tos are great. I believe that how-tos are effective, and I believe that they have their time and their purpose. I read a book, and it said if how-tos worked, we'd all be happy, skinny, and healthy, or happy, skinny, and rich. It's not about how-to. Today I want to tell you why and what, and to understand it's not a how-to, it's a must-do. If you want to live life, church, if you want to have fulfillment, church, if you want to know the answer to the questions of your life, this is not a how-to, it's a must-do. You and I must be Christ-conscious in our lives. That everything we focus on, that everything we fix on, everything that we gaze upon in our lives must be centered and focused on Jesus, because otherwise, the things of this world, the things of our life, the things of that go on around us will scream at us, will try to take our attention, will take us away from what God has for you and I. But let me tell you something, God's got plans for you. God's got desires for you. God's got a will and a hope for you. And many of you are in this place today and you hate the way you act. But in order to change the way you act, you have got to change the way you think. Let me say that again. In order to change the way you act, you've got to change the way you think. Consciousness, awareness, what's going on? What are you focusing on? What are you fixed on? What are you looking at in your life? Because in order for us to change, church, maybe I'm talking Chinese to you today, but I'll preach to myself tonight. In order to bring about the change I desire and I need in my life, I've got to change the way I think. You're in Hebrews chapter 12. I'll put up Romans chapter 12. Romans chapter 12, verse number 1, talks about living our lives as a sacrifice to God, as reasonable service, our bodies to present them. Verse number 2, again, a very familiar verse for you and I. It says, do not be transformed or conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is the good and the acceptable and the perfect will of God. Church, in order for us to be who God has called us to be, in order for us to be the change that Christ so desires in our lives, to no longer be who we once were, but to be who God has called us to be, it will never happen until we change the way we think. That is our consciousness. Let me just say it like this. Your actions are the results of thoughts. Pastor Luke, that's not true. I act so many times without thinking it through. I know it seems like that. I'll be the king of it. They say, think before you speak. I'm like the king of not thinking before I speak. But you see, all actions are the results of a thought. All actions are the results of something on the inside of us, whether it's in our subconscious or whether it's in the front of our minds. We have been feeding the seed that was planted on the inside of us to the point where now it comes out on the outside of us. The actions that bring you and I grief in our lives are the results of our consciousness and what we're focusing on. And when we want to be like Christ, when we want to be a reflection of God's glory, when we want to live a life of meaning and of desire and reason, when we want our family and our friends to see God's goodness and glory in our life, it has to start from the inside and work its way out by working and looking and realizing that our consciousness cannot be on the things that we desire, but rather our consciousness must always be fixed on Jesus Christ. So today it's not a how-to, but it's a must-do. We talked about these consciousness. These are the ones that I walked through. Somebody told me last week, Pastor Luke, I just so appreciate the transparency on the pulpits of the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We are all human. I hate to burst your bubble if you think that the person up here preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ is God's perfect being, but I'll tell you something. I am a person, and these are the things that I work through every day, and I know that these are the things that you work through every day, but I'll tell you what, we can get beyond these. Go beyond these issues. Go beyond these thoughts. Go beyond these consciousness of our lives and focus on Jesus, because that's God's desire. Self-conscious. The self-conscious life says to you and I, speaks to us in our hearts, I know what I want. This is my life. I will do what I want. I'll feed my pleasures and my desires. This is my one chance to be happy at life. My self-conscious, I am acutely aware of what I want to do, and I'm going to do it. Self-conscious says, I'll speak. I'll say, I'll do the things that I want to do because it's what I want to do because I am aware of I, me, myself, and I. And you see, what that does for you and I is it alienates us from our witness. It takes us away from the effective gospel of Jesus Christ that the Bible tells us that we are a shining example of God's glory and God's goodness. You see, I live for me is what self-conscious says, but Paul the Apostle tells us, and I'll put it up on the overhead. Paul the Apostle tells us in Galatians, it is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. You see, you and I, when we come to Jesus Christ, when we become Christ aware, it's no longer about self-consciousness. It's no longer about me, myself, and I, my desires, my life, my wishes, my wants, my dreams, my hang-ups, my perks, my good and my bad. It's now about Jesus, Christ consciousness. Why? Because I died when I found Jesus. The I that was self-aware and self-awake and focusing and fixing on my own self, that person died, and now I found Jesus and I live Christ conscious. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. The life I live in the flesh by Christ, the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. You see, church, God's desire is for us to not live a life of selfish desires and ambitions, but to lay our lives down at the foot of Jesus that we might become Christ conscious, so that when we look to ourselves and we say, this is what I want to do, this is what I want to say, this is who I want to be, we no longer say that. Why? Because we say, it's not about me. It's about Jesus. It's about Jesus. You've got liberties. The Bible tells you you've got all sorts of liberties. But that's why Paul tells the church, hey, you've got freedoms in Christ. But be careful. Why? Because your life's not about you. Freedom with the self-conscious desire says, I will live life for me because I can. But the life of Christ-centered, a Christ-centered or a Christ-conscious life says, I will do what I need to do to live. Why? I will lay my life down for the sake of others because it's no longer about me. It's about Jesus. And what Jesus, his desire, what God's will is what my will. And that's why Jesus says, my meat, my life, my food is to do the will and the work of the Father. Church, you and I, our will, our conscience now, when we are Christ-centered, when we are Christ-conscious in our life, is to do the work of the Father, to be effective witnesses to the people around us. To say my life is no longer about my own passions or my own desires, but now it's about Jesus. Because Jesus lives on the inside of me. And I don't want to be a selfish person. Like Pastor Dan, man, he hit the nail on the head today talking about his message. If you didn't get it, go get it. Go listen to it online. He who dies with the most toys still dies. When you die, you're not going to take anything with you. The only thing that will stay on this planet is the legacy that you leave behind. The legacy that you leave behind are the lives that you affect. Are you going to affect them for you, for your desires, for your wants? Are you going to affect them for Jesus? To share with them the love of Christ, to show them that God so loved you that he so loved them, because you are a living example of Jesus to this world. That's why we have to be Christ conscious. Many of us in this place today, we live sick conscious. I'll just tell you in my own life, that's me. My wife, she makes fun of me. Why? Because as soon as something happens, I'm the guy that goes on WebMD. Yeah, I know some of you are like, oh man. Yeah, because if you go on WebMD and you hit your finger with a hammer, you'll die of cancer. I don't know what it is about my body. You know, maybe it's the things that I put myself through when I was a teenager. But my body at 32 years old wants to fall apart. I've got all sorts of different diagnoses, and I've got all sorts of different references to different surgeons and doctors and things going on. My knees and my hips and my shoulders and my neck and my back and everything else. My body screams in pain sometimes. Some of you know what I'm talking about. Some of you say, Pastor Luke, you don't even understand what pain is. Many of us in this place live sick conscious. We live listening to the pain. We are acutely awake and aware of the pain that's on the inside of our body, what the doctor said about us, what somebody spoke over us as a child, or what's going on right now in our lives. And we are so fixed, and we are so focused, and we are so conscious of what's going on the inside of us that we miss out on what God has for us. God's desire for you, church, is to not live sick conscious. To not focus on the pain, the afflictions, and the bondages, the things that hold you down and take you from being who God has called you to be. You see, God's desire is not for you to focus on that. His desire is for us to focus on Jesus, to be Christ conscious. Because when we focus on our sickness, it becomes too big. You don't understand. The word terminal is in front of my focus. Let me tell you something. Nothing is too big for God. That's why it says about Jesus in the book of Isaiah, the 53rd chapter, that he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And by his stripes, church, we are healed. That Jesus in his ministry went about healing all who were sick and afflicted of the devil. Why? Because we are no longer sick conscious. We are Christ conscious. My body screams. It hurts. The doctors say this. Somebody spoke that over you. The terminal cancer or the diagnosis or whatever it might be, screams at you to focus on it, but God says, stop focusing on the pain, on the sickness, on the hurt, and start focusing on Jesus, because by his stripes, church, you are healed. And we walk around sick and limping. We walk around destroyed and beaten and oppressed by the devil, but yet we have got to understand that our consciousness, our focus, our awareness must be on Christ and the fact that Jesus is our healer. It's not about what the doctor said. It's not about what my body screams at me every day when I wake up. It's not about looking at the future thinking I'm 30 years old and I have to have surgery on my knees and my hips and they tell me hip replacements and tears and all these different things. What happens when I'm 40? It's not about that. It's the fact that Jesus is my great physician, that Jesus, by what he bore on that cross, he bore my sickness, he bore my infirmities, and I'll focus and I'll fix my eyes and my heart and my gaze and my life upon him, and I'll live my life aware and awake, not of my pain, but of my Savior, my healer, my doctor, my physician. We live this way. Many of us live world conscious of what's going on around us. The latest trends and the latest fashion or what's going on or the newest sitcom or the latest movie that's coming out. Many of us live conscious about what others are seeing or what others are saying. I heard the tragic story of a young man who got radically saved by hearing the words and the gospel of Jesus Christ, and he in his life became Christ conscious. But what happened is he began to realize that people liked him when he was world conscious. People liked him when he was keeping up with the Joneses, when he was drinking and when he was smoking with them, and when he was doing all the things that everybody else was doing. Everybody liked him and he fit in. And he began to realize and he began to see in his life that the more he became Christ conscious, the more the world stopped liking him. And the tragedy of the story is that he couldn't hold on. He couldn't hang on. Why? Because he didn't fit into the world around him. Church, the Bible tells us that Jesus tells his disciples, you and I are no longer of this world. We live in this world, but we are not of this world. Why? To be Christ conscious is to realize that I don't need the world. I don't need the approval of the people around me. I don't need followers on Facebook or on Twitter. I don't need people to like what I do in my life. Because my consciousness, my awareness, the fact that I'm awake, I realize that Jesus is the author and the finisher of my faith. That everything that matters in my life comes from Jesus and not from the world. That's why John says in 1 John 4:4, little children, do you not know you have overcome, you are of God, because he who is in you is he who is greater than he who is in the world. Church, we are separated and disconnected. Don't let your heart fail when the people of the world stop liking you because you're not world conscious anymore. Why? You don't need them because you're Christ conscious. Because you realize what your family, what your friends, what the people around you say, and they may not like you or agree with you anymore. The Bible says, blessed are those who are persecuted for my name's sake, for theirs is the kingdom of God. You see, my consciousness is focused and is fixed on Jesus, the answer to everything I need in life, both good and bad. It's Jesus. And when I focus on him, I don't worry about what's going on around me. I don't worry about the financial systems of the world. I don't worry about the stock market. I don't worry about my retirement. I don't worry about anything else. Why? Because the Bible tells me that if God will take care of the flowers of the field and the birds of the air, that my God will take care of me. To seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto me. I don't have to worry. Why? Because I am fixed on Jesus. We live world conscious. We live sin conscious. Those thoughts, those things that you tell yourself, and you know it. You're terrible. You're worthless. God can't love you. You are a mess up all your life, and now you can't keep going on, and you'll always be a mess up. These are the thoughts that you tell yourself in your sin consciousness. You are awake and aware of your mess ups. You are awake and aware of every little thing that you do that is in opposition to God, and it feeds you day in and day out. It consumes your thoughts. No matter how much you come and you try to give it to God, that little thought comes into the back of your mind that tells you, church, hey, you know what? You're not good enough. How could God love you? You see, a life of sin consciousness will rip you from the arms of God. Why? Because you'll come in feeling like you've never been worthy, never been good enough. And you'll never be good enough for God. But you see, God's desire for us is to not live sin conscious, to not focus on how much we mess up, to not focus on how many failures we've had. Despite how hard we try, it seems like I can't get over, we can't get over, we can't get over. God desires for you not to be so acutely awake and aware of your sin. He says, I want you to be acutely awake and aware of me, of Jesus on the inside of you. Why? Because the Bible tells us in Romans, chapter 5, verse number 8. God demonstrates his love. He shows his magnificent love for humanity, and that in while we were still sinners, church, Christ died for us. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that we fix ourselves to come to Jesus. Why? Because we focus on Jesus, and he is the answer to our problems, not our sin awareness. It says that while we were sinners, Christ died. How much more than having been justified by the blood of Jesus shall we be saved through him. Look what it says, verse number 10. For if when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his son, much more having been reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. And I love what verse number 11 says. This is Christ consciousness. It says, we should rejoice in our God. through the Lord Jesus Christ, from whom we have received the reconciliation. Church, sin consciousness brings condemnation to our lives, where we feel like God is hovering over us in disgust, looking at us saying, I sent my son to die for you. But in reality, the Bible tells us that while we were enemies of God, Jesus Christ died for us. And the words of God are not to you and I, you are disgusting, you are terrible, you are a failure. The words of God to you and I, church, are you can do this, you can make this. That's not who you were. You are a son and a daughter of the Most High, and I believe in you. You see, when we are Christ conscious, we don't worry about what we did. We look at Jesus and we realize that it's not about what we do in our lives. It's not about how hard. Why? Because the math equation, my friend Keith Hersey said it like this: Jesus is all, and it cannot be 1 + 1 = 1, which means Jesus does it all. We come to Jesus and we are aware that Jesus, by the grace of God, equates the change on the inside of us, and we are the righteousness of God in Christ through him. Oh, an author once said, I think I've got the quote up on the overheads, if you and I spend more time confessing our faith, we'll need less time confessing our sins. You see, we get so wrapped up in our problems, so wrapped up in our mistakes. Oh, you dummy, you did it again. How could God love somebody like you? You're a failure. That's not what God says. You see, the Holy Spirit comes upon you and he reminds us of our righteousness. Jesus says his job is to remind us of the things that he's taught us, that we are the righteousness of God in Christ through him, that we can do this, that I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And when I become Christ conscious, I stop thinking about the elephant in the room and I leave it behind. Why? Because now it's not me who brings the change in me, it's Christ who brings the change in me. And all of a sudden, my life begins to change. You see, Jesus, to the woman who was caught in the act of adultery, as they dragged her out, I imagine they dragged her by her hair and by her clothes, and they picked up rocks to stone her, and they came to question Jesus, and they said she was caught. What do you do? And Jesus says to the Pharisees, he who has no sin, throw the first stone. And there they begin to drop the stones. And what does Jesus say to her? He says, woman, where are your accusers? He says, go and sin no more. Neither I condemn you. Caught in the act, caught in the sin, and Jesus says, I don't condemn you. Go and sin no more. See, we've been forgiven of great sins, church. Sins we don't even realize. The sin of humanity that was born into us. But yet, now we are free from that, from the slavery and the bondages of that which held us back. Why? Because we focus and we fix our eyes on Jesus Christ, the author and the finisher of our faith. No longer is it about what we did, it's about Jesus and what he did. And when we focus on what he did, our lives will be changed inside out. Our consciousness will change and our sin nature will begin to dissolve. Why? Because we are perfect in the eyes of God when we are Christ conscious. Many of you in this place today are just living unconscious. It's a shame. There are so many Christians in this world today that are walking about their lives living unconscious to the world around them, waiting and wanting and hoping. God, I'm waiting for a change. God, I desire for you to do something. I read your word, and yet I'm waiting for you to do something in my life, not realizing and unaware that we are asleep to the things of this world, that our eyes are closed and that we're focused somewhere else and that we're in la-la land, spiritually speaking. But you see, God's desire for us is to not live a life of unconsciousness, to be walking zombies of this earth, hoping that we might get to the next day. God says to you and I, wake up, church. It's not about what you do tomorrow. It's not about what happens next year. He says, the time is now for you and I. Romans chapter 13, look what it says. This is the time. Now is high time to wake out of our sleep, for our salvation is nearer than when we first believed. Well, Pastor Luke, I got to wait till next year to do this thing, or I got to do this, and maybe in a couple months. No, church, the time is now. We got to stop living unconscious, waiting for something to fall on our laps, and open our eyes to Jesus to realize that because of Jesus, we have him now. Our time is now to act, to wake up, to step out in the things of God. Don't wait for tomorrow. Don't wait for what goes on. You've got today. That's why it's called a present. Focus on Jesus, to fix our eyes on Jesus, to look at him, the author and the finisher of our faith. The critics say, Pastor Luke, what you say is great. It's so much easier said than it is done. You know, there's some truth to that. But the point of the matter is, it's not a how-to. Why? Because what you put as a priority of your life will become a priority. And many of you in this place, you were Christ-centered, Christ-conscious when you first came in. And maybe the noise of self came creeping back in. Maybe the distractions of the world came creeping back in. Maybe the sin consciousness and the voice of the sin of humanity came creeping back into your life, and now all of a sudden you say, I used to be that guy, but not me anymore. But church, the answer always is and always will be Jesus. There's no new way. There's no new steps. 2,000 years ago to 2,000 years from now, the answer is and always will be Jesus, church, to fix your eyes on Jesus. You know, in the book of Numbers, there's a story of the children of Israel. And they rebelled against God and they spoke against Moses. And God sent to them as a time in the dispensation of the Old Testament and of the Old Covenant. God sent to them fiery serpents that bit them, and many of them were sick and they died, and they were plagued by these serpents because of their disobedience against God. And they cried out to God, God, we need an answer. God, we need a solution. God, we are focused on the serpents biting us in our lives. God spoke to Moses, make a serpent out of bronze and put it on a pole and lift it up high into the air. And every person that looks at that, every person that fixes their eyes on that serpent, every person that becomes conscious of that will be healed. You see, Jesus tells Nicodemus in John the 3rd chapter, verse number 14, like Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so the Son of Man must be lifted up. Verse number 15, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. Verse number 16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Verse number 17, why? Because he did not come to condemn the world, but that through the world, through him, might be saved. Church, your consciousness, it stands out to you. It screams at you. Every day, you're acutely aware of the world and the surroundings. It's huge to you. This is what I focus on. What we do all day long is we look and we're over here to the side and we say, I want to be like that. And we fix our eyes over here. I want to be like that. And we fix our eyes over here. I want to be like that. But we fix our eyes over here. Church, what do? We take these things that are huge in our life, the world, our sicknesses, and we nail them to the cross of Jesus Christ. We take them. We nail them to the cross of Jesus Christ. Why? Because that is where our focus is on. The world around us may seem huge when we gaze at it, but it's not so big on the cross. Your sickness, it might seem like it's a monster in your life. Might seem like there's nothing else you can focus on. But you take that. You take that consciousness of your life and you nail it to the cross of Jesus Christ. And all of a sudden, that doctor's report isn't so big anymore. All of a sudden, that bondage that you've been living through, it's not so big anymore. You take that self-consciousness, those desires, but Pastor Luke, I've got a will, I've got desires, I've got plans for my life. God's got bigger plans. God's got better plans. To stop looking and say, I want to be like that, but I focus over here. I want to be like that, but I focus over here. But to take this, our consciousness, our life, and we nail it to the cross of Jesus Christ. The handwriting of the requirements of this world are written out. Our sin that hovers over us. The voice in your head that tells you that you're not good enough, that you'll never be good enough, that God can't love you, that you might as well give up, you might as well stop fighting because you can't make it. You take that which seems so big to you because you're aware of it, you're awake, and you focus on the cross of Jesus Christ, and you nail it, and all of a sudden that voice must be silenced. Why? Because Jesus Christ did not come to condemn this world. He came to save this world. God's plan for you, church, is to not live a life focused on yourself, focused on others, focused on sickness, focused on sin, or unconscious in his life, Jesus says, I want you, my church, to wake up and to realize that I am everything you need. I am everything you'll ever need. There is nothing in this world that cannot stand to the cross of Jesus. And the problems, when they're big to us, when nailed to the cross, are no longer huge. Why? Because the cross is always bigger. The cross is always bigger. Jesus is always bigger. Stop letting the sin nature of humanity hover over you. Stop focusing on your failures, your sicknesses, what people are saying about you. And church, let's focus on Jesus. Why? Because he wants us to live a life that shines the glory of God. And that life is not about us gazing at ourselves, but about Jesus. And when we do, your world will change. When you do, when you focus on Jesus, the words of God stop being words on a page. When you become Christ conscious, and all of a sudden everything that comes your way, financial hardships, children going wayward, jobs getting lost or getting gained, whatever it might be, vacations coming or things going, whatever it might be, when you become Christ conscious, nothing, can rattle the foundations of your life. Why? Because everything that seems big in our lives is small in comparison to the cross of Jesus. Church, it's time for us to wake up. It's time for us to be aware. It's time for us to be awake. Because there is a world out there that needs Jesus. But even more so, there's a world in here that needs Jesus. You're in this place tonight. You need Jesus. You need him. And he wants you. He loves you. He is for you, not against you. There is therefore no condemnation in Christ. We just must learn, the Son of Man lifted high, like the children of Israel now, to stop focusing on the serpents that are surrounding us in our lives, but to focus on the cross of Jesus Christ, because on that, everything we need is answered. Amen. Everything we need is answered in our lives. Amen. Tonight, I want to just take a couple of minutes. Our worship team is going to come out. Maybe you've been living a conscious life of something around you. Maybe my five consciousness that I deal with aren't your consciousness. Fill in the blank. You've been whatever it is conscious. Maybe it's time for us to let that conscious go. To nail it to the cross of Jesus Christ. To fix and to focus our eyes on Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. That we might let everything else go around us and be who God has called us to be. To live a life that God has called us to live. I'm just going to take a couple of minutes. Elijah, is it just you? You're the only one singing? London's coming. She better hurry. I want to take a couple of minutes. They're going to sing a song. And if you've been holding on to consciousness, maybe it's your sin consciousness, maybe it's your sick consciousness, maybe it's your world consciousness, whatever it might be, you've been holding on to a consciousness and you realize today, I have got to get Christ conscious in my life. I want to open up the altars. They're going to sing a song. And I want you to come. And in your heart, no, I don't want you to come up on the stage, but I want you to come here. And in your heart, I want you to nail it, in spiritually speaking, to the cross of Jesus Christ. Commit your consciousness, your focus, your gaze upon him. To look upon the cross of Jesus and to fix your eyes upon him, because he is the answer to everything that you need. So they're going to sing that song, and we'll just come up here, and if you want, just come up here and get down on your knees and give it to God. And today, you leave it here on the altar at the foot of the cross of Jesus Christ, because there is the answer to everything you need. Guys, go ahead and sing.
So
Father, we just come before you tonight. We fix our eyes on the glorious and the precious cross of Jesus. Lord, forgive us in this place if we've been focused on ourselves, if we've been focused on others, and we've been focused on the world. Teach us through your word and through your Holy Spirit that leads us and guides us every day of our lives to fix our eyes on Jesus, the helper that you've promised us to come upon us, Lord, in the faith of Jesus, that you would remind us of who we are, not of who we were. We are dead, but now we are alive in Christ. Lord, thank you for the strength to continue on each and every day. Lord, the strength to not worry about what tomorrow holds because we don't focus on our problems, we don't focus on our issues, we don't focus on our worries, we focus on Jesus. Lord, today we commit in our hearts and our lives that we are awake to Jesus, that we are aware to Jesus. Maybe we don't talk about Jesus enough, but Lord, he is everything in our lives. He is the name above names in our lives. He is the greatest of all things in our lives. The only thing we ever need in our lives is Jesus. And Lord, forgive us that we've sought for answers in other areas. Lord, that we've sought for direction from other people. But Lord, today we seek direction from Jesus, from his word, from his life, from his truth, from his grace in our lives that would lead us each and every day to become who you've called us to be. And Lord, we thank you that we leave these burdens here at the foot of your cross. We no longer focus on our sin. We no longer focus on ourselves. We no longer focus on our sickness. We no longer focus on our world. We no longer live a life of unconsciousness. Lord, we are a Christ-conscious church because we live today for Jesus. The life that we live, it's no longer for us, but for Jesus who lives on the inside of us. Today, we give you the praise, Lord. We thank you, like Romans tells us in verse number 11, that we can rejoice. We can rejoice no longer in condemnation, but in rejoicing and singing like Elijah sang tonight, that we can dance the night away. Why? Because, God, we are reconciled to you. We are brought close to you. We are no longer on the outside looking in, but now we are children of the Most High God, connected to Jesus through his blood. God, when you look at us, you don't see our sin. You see Jesus on us. And, Lord, we thank you that today we put on Christ. We wake up to the world around us, and we live according to the gospel by focusing on our answer, Jesus Christ. To you be the praise and the glory and the honor. In Jesus' mighty name, we all said, amen. Amen. Let's give the Lord a great big praise. If you got something out of tonight, give the Lord a great big praise in this house. Before we go any further tonight, before we conduct the business that we got to conduct, you know, I want to just ensure. I don't know every person in this place. I don't know where you stand in your position with God. But today I want to give you the opportunity to examine your heart, to examine your lives. I want you to look into your heart, to look into your lives, to look after what God says. You see, the Bible tells us that it's not about what we do. It's not about the lives that we live. It's not about the outward action. We talked about that. If you want to change the way you are, it's not about what you do on the outside. It's about changing who you are on the inside. You see, so often what happens is we come to church and we think that everything's okay in our lives. We think that everything's right with us in our lives. Why? Because we come to church. Because we hear the pastor preach. Because we said amen. Because we sang a couple of songs. But did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that your relationship, your connection to God through Jesus Christ happens because you attend a church service and hear the pastor preach? Nowhere in the Word of God does it say that you're okay with God because you think that you're okay with God. Man, I'll tell you what, there have been people that I've gone through my life thinking I'm okay with them, thinking that everything's all right, and then the first time I see them after a long period of time, they're mad at me. What did I do? I thought I was all right with you. Listen, church, just because you think you're okay doesn't mean you're okay. It doesn't mean you're in right standing. It doesn't mean that you're going to make it to heaven. Today, just because you volunteer, because you're involved in church, because you're here tonight, nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you're a good person, because you do good things, because you give to charitable organizations, nowhere in the Word of God does it say that those are the things that make you right with God. You see, the only way you and I can get right with God is to become Christ conscious. Christ consciousness doesn't just come because I want it, because I think so, because I hope so. You see, Jesus, in that same conversation that we read in John 3:16, was talking to a religious leader. A man by the name of Nicodemus who did all the right things, who said all the right things, who gave to the poor, who memorized the scriptures and the word of God. And yet Jesus says to Nicodemus, in order to see the kingdom of God, you must be born again. Why? Because it's not about you and I and what we do on the outside and our outward actions towards God. God says, I want something deeper. I want something greater. I want something more intimate between you and I. I want a wholehearted relationship. Born again. It's not what the society and Hollywood and culture's made it out to be. Born again from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible has always meant the same thing in the heart and the eyes of God. It means that you've given God all of your heart. You've given God all of your life. That's how we become Christ conscious, by surrendering our heart, by surrendering our life to the leadership and the lordship of Jesus Christ. You see, it's an all or nothing relationship with God the Father through his son, Jesus, who died for you and I on a cross 2,000 years ago on Calvary. He bore our sin, our shame. You see, we're never good enough on our own. We can never work hard enough or pay enough money to be right with God. Why? Because God didn't want that. He gave for us Jesus to die on a cross so that we might lift our eyes and see that our salvation is closer today than it has ever been today. To focus and to fix our eyes on Jesus. To not live a life of self, to live a life of desires, to live a life seeking after. Why? Because we've done that. You've spent your entire life living for self, trying to fill the emptiness and the void and the hollow parts on the inside of you with money, with fulfillment of people or of friends, of position or whatever it might be. But you see, you realize that there's an emptiness on the inside of you. There's a void on the inside of you that's a God-sized hole that nothing you and I could ever do to fill it would ever make us full and fulfilled. Why? Because God gave us Jesus for that hole, to bridge the gap between humanity. And Jesus says these words in the book of Revelation. It's his last plea to his church. It's his final plea to us to say, stop. Stop, church, living life like you do. Stop doing it on your own. Stop thinking that you're good enough. He says, you think that you're wealthy. You think that you're full. You think that you're glorious, but you don't realize that you're naked and destitute. Oh, I wish, he says, that you would come to me. He says, I'd rather, when I come back, rather find that you're hot. I'd rather find that you're cold, because he says, if I find that you're lukewarm, I'll vomit you from my mouth. I know it's a shocking statement, but Jesus is getting our attention by saying, please stop living a life conscious of self, a life conscious of others, a life conscious of sickness and of sin. Please start living a life conscious of me, because I died for you, he says, that you might live. Today I want to give you the opportunity in this house. Maybe you realize, you know what, I've been living a life for me. I've been doing things my way, you know, and I came up and I gave it to Christ, but maybe you're in this place today and you know that there's something more that you need to do. Today I want to give you that opportunity. Jesus says these words. He says that if you confess him before men, he will confess you before his Father. He says, but if you deny him, he will deny you. The decision's yours. God's not a manipulator. He's not a conniver. He's not going to force his way or make his way. And you see, he's already done everything he could for you and I to ensure our reconciliation, our salvation, our being connected to God by giving Jesus to die a beaten, bloody mess on the cross for us 2,000 years ago. A spectacle for humanity to see, that we could be reunited to God today. Today I want to give you that opportunity. The Bible tells us that it's a gift. The gift of God is eternal salvation through Jesus Christ. The gift of God is his Holy Spirit through Jesus Christ. And today you can have that. Your life can be fulfilled. The emptiness and the course that you've been taking, you can make that about face, and you can go to the cross and fix your eyes on Jesus and find life as he promises us in John the 10th chapter. But it starts by making a decision. It starts by changing your life, committing it to the lordship of Jesus Christ. In a moment, I'm going to count to three. I'll go one, two, and on the count of three, I'll go three, and I'll smack my hands. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to ask you to do something bold when I smack my hands. I'm going to ask you to pop your hand up. You see, by raising of your hands, what you're doing in this place today is you're saying, I want to give my heart. I want to give my life to Jesus. You know, maybe you're in this place and you've never given him your heart. You've never given him your life. If that's you, in just a moment, get ready. Pop your hand up, I'll see it. Maybe you're in this place today and you say, you know what, maybe I thought I did this as a child. I did that in youth group. I prayed that prayer once before at Harvest or on a TV ministry, but I never really followed through with it. If you're not sure in this place today of your position with God, of your standing with God, listen, don't walk out of this place without making sure. That's a gamble on your eternal life you can't afford to make. Today is a day of your salvation. Who should raise your hands if you've never given him your heart, never given him your life? If you're not sure, how about this? If you've been living lukewarm, like Jesus said in the book of Revelation, if you've been living life for you, If you've been focused on you, you've been doing the church thing on Sunday or on Wednesday or whatever day it is you go to church, but then the rest of the week you're doing your thing. Church, that's no way to live. God doesn't want you to live that way. With Big Brother looking over your shoulder, God wants you to accept life through Jesus Christ. And it starts by committing your heart and committing your life. And today is the day for you to do that. To stop running from God and to start running to God. Today is the day of your salvation. Listen, you've had doctors and dentists and DMV appointments. Today is a divine appointment between you and God. Because ultimately the Bible tells us that it's the goodness of God that draws men to repentance. It's not about me. Not about cunning or crafty words. Not about songs or goosebumps on your arms. It's God's goodness in your life speaking to you, telling you, calling you, come home to me. And if that's you in this place today, it's time for you to respond to the call of Jesus on your life and to answer that by looking up, because your salvation draws near in Jesus Christ. And today I want to give you that opportunity. All across this auditorium, when I count to three, if that's you, get ready to pop your hand up. You say, man, if I raise my hand, Pastor, like, I don't know if I am brave enough to do that. I'm going to be embarrassed. I'm not going to embarrass you. Even if you were, wouldn't it be better to spend a moment of embarrassment than an eternity in hell? Because you see, ultimately, it's your choice. It's your decision. Today, choose life in Jesus. Wherever you're at in this place, from the side to the side, from the front row to the back rows, even if you're at home watching online or on television, wherever you're at, if that's you in this place today, this is your moment, this is your time. The day of your salvation is closer than it has ever been, and it's time for you, church, to wake up. This is the call of God on your life, and now it's time to respond by making that decision. When I count to three, if that's you, pop your hand up, I'll see it, I'll acknowledge you, put it right back down, and we'll go forward together from there. I'm gonna count to three, and when I do, if that's you, get ready. This is your moment, this is your time. The Spirit of God speaking to you today, it's time to respond. It's time to answer. It's time to accept and to choose life in Jesus. And it starts by making that decision. And we'll follow through together right afterwards. You ready? I'm going to count to three. And when I do, if that's you, get ready. Pop your hand up. This is your moment. Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands in this place today. Say, I want to give my heart. I want to give my life to Jesus. I see you right over there. See you right over there. Anybody else in this place and say, I see you, I see you, I see you. I see you right over there. Anybody else in this place, you say, man, I wonder if I should. If I saw your hands, you can put it down. Anybody else, you say, man, I wonder if I should. This is your moment. No questions asked. Come on, this is the time for you to choose life. You feel that a call on the inside of you. It's time to start your walk with God on the right foot. Anybody else in this place today, you say, man, I wonder if I should. This is your moment. This is your time. Anybody else in the house today? I think there was about five or six wise people in the house today. Let's give the Lord a great big praise. Amen. For those of you today, you raise your hands. Man, some of you, you said, I'm waving at you. I want you to see it. You don't get saved by raising your hand. You get saved by inviting Jesus. You said you're making a decision. That's what we said. I'm making that choice. And now with every decision, like we talked about, every decision requires action. To do something in your life, not to just think that everything's okay. We're going to do that together. We're going to follow through together. We're going to take action on that decision and change destinies together right here, right now. So I'm going to ask everybody in a moment to stand up. And as we do, if you raised your hands or you should have raised your hand, I want you to grab your coat, your sweater, your purse, your Bible, a friend if you need a friend. Maybe you didn't raise your hand, but you know that's you. You know that's your calling today. God's speaking to you. The Holy Spirit's drawing you in. If that's you in this place, get out of your chair, get out of your seat, get into the aisle, and come meet me up here at this altar. And let's change destinies together right here, right now, you and I. Let's all stand together. Please, nobody leave. But if that's you in this place, you come. This is your moment. This is your time. Wherever you're at, you come. Come on. This is your moment. Hey guys, you came. Good job. You know, maybe nobody's ever told you in your life, that you're doing a good job. Hey, congratulations. Good job. Congratulations. You're doing good. You're doing good. Somebody needs to compliment you, to encourage you, to tell you you can do this. You're making the greatest choice, the greatest decision you could ever make in your lives. Today's a great day. The best day of your life is ahead of you. Today I want to do something. I want to introduce a friend of mine to you. See this guy right over here waving at you in this cool black jacket? I tried to be like him and wear a sweater, but I'm sweating like a pig. See that guy right over there? His name's Pastor Joel. Pastor Joel's a really cool guy. He's going to do a couple things with you. He's going to take you guys right over there. Nothing weird goes on, I promise. All right, he's going to lead you guys in a prayer to accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, the leader of your life. He's going to give you some free literature. We don't want you to leave empty-handed today. We're going to point you in the right direction as you walk out of here. We're going to help set you up for success. The third thing he's going to do is he's going to invite you to come back to hang out with a friend, somebody that will teach you with the gospel, the word of God, to get you strong in the ways of God. We're not asking you to join some big, long program. We're asking you to come back and hang out with us. Get connected with a friend here in church. Meet with somebody, and he'll tell you all about that. So if you guys just turn to your left, my right, go right over there with Pastor Joel. We'll be here hanging out right after church, all right? Praise God.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son, and that you sent him for me, and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.